And welcome to Hero Power. This is episode 59, Technical Difficulties.
There you go.
All right, guys. As always, I am your host, Avantes, and I am joined by my co-hosts, Zerotio.
Hey, hey, hey. Sorry, helping with some technical difficulties.
Yeah. I'm looking.
And Versica.
How's it going, guys?
So, all
we're
right.
We're live, finally.
Yeah, we are live, finally. Only took 15 minutes and a workaround. So, yep. We'll troubleshoot the issues after the show. That being said, guys, welcome. We've got a lot to cover and now a minimal amount of time to talk about it. So, let's jump right into it. Versica, tell us a little bit about ViForce.
Well, it is that time where it's kind of past the time to get your new system before Christmas, but it doesn't mean you still can't get it for Christmas. So, ViForceGaming.com, go there, check out, see what they have to offer. My system is incoming. One of the neat little things that they do is when you order the system, it's kind of like the Domino's pizza maker where you order Domino's and it says so-and-so is preparing your pizza, so-and-so is put your pizza in the oven, your pizza is cooking in the oven, it's out for delivery. Well, they kind of do the same thing with your system as it's being built. So I got the little notification that the system was being built. So I'm anxiously awaiting it, and I'll be doing an unboxing video when I get it. But if you're wanting to do your system, if you're wanting to go on and build your system, go to ViForceGaming.com. If they don't have one you like, you can customize it, and then you can start your own Domino's pizza-esque journey as you walk through your system and still get it in time for the New Year's and hopefully be able to start the New Year off with a great gaming machine and be able to play the new Overwatch holiday content, which, by the way, have you guys delved into that at all?
Open day loot box. That's as much as I've done.
Yeah, same here.
So guess what I got out of my loot box, Zerotio?
Oh, don't. Oh, you're a jerk. Torbjorn Santa?
Yep.
Oh, I'll strangle you.
It's Torbjorn!
Torbjorn!
Am I actually playing now?
I'm Swedish.
All right. Well, we got no emails this week. We do have one new patron to mention, and we want to shout out a big thank you to Dan for joining us. We're excited to have you.
So awesome.
Yeah, no new iTunes reviews. So that
it's
brings
the holidays.
Us...
Everybody's busy.
Yeah, that's true. Everybody's very busy this time of year. And that's fine, because we're busy as well. But we've not near as busy as the new game director of Hearthstone. How'd you like that segue? Right?
Nice. Right?
Congratulations to Ben Brode on being promoted to game director for Hearthstone.
Awesome.
Yeah, this is really cool. You could tell there's been some shaking up a little bit of roles with Matt Place kind of stepping into the position that Yang Wu kind of took in the role. I don't want to say position because there's been no other role confirmed promotions. And then Yang Wu kind of transitioning into kind of the voice that was Ben Brode before. And a lot of people assumed it was because he had to take some time off for his kid being born and all that. But it looks like his actual was a promotion being brewed in. So that's kind of cool.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'd say there's probably not very many people there that could be in better hands. So,
say that again?
The game couldn't be in anybody else's better hands.
I thought you said the people couldn't be in any better hands. I think that violates some HR stuff.
just depends on, you know, some other factors, but we're not here to talk about that.
That's usually frowned upon.
It is. All right. So that brings us to
Have you guys been watching Life Coach, his stream?
No, I have not.
He has been streaming both, actually, because he's been streaming more often in preparation for post Gadget Zan tournaments, and G2 has been doing this 100 hours a week of Hearthstone training since the release of Gadget Stand. So the last 2 weeks, they put in 100 hours a week in the G2, well, it's in Life Coach and Wife Coach's house, which they've had Eloise there, Pavel, JJ's.
Just to make it easier, they no longer refer to it as their house. They call it the Hearthstone house.
Yes. And what's really neat is he's actually started a YouTube page. So go to youtube.com/lifecoachhs, and you can see all of his roads to the tournament, specifically Seat Story, which actually starts tomorrow, the 15th through the 18th.
Yep.
Yeah. And I'm
speaking of G2, there's not a lot of G2 on in the morning when I get up, but I do tune into Tice in the mornings while I'm eating my breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
So 4:30 a.m. Tice.
Yep.
Yeah.
I get up every morning to an email that Tice has gone live, and I'm like, well, that's great. I was asleep 3 hours ago.
if you ever want to see kind of inside the life of a Hearthstone professional, go to Life Coach's YouTube page, because he does these vlogs, and they're done in ways that it's not just sitting and watching someone play Hearthstone. It does show some of that, some of their scrimmages, some of their practices and mindsets they go through, but it also goes into the life of having guests over and what are they eating and how are they preparing for the tournaments, not just in a Hearthstone manner, but in, you know, their sleep schedules, their eating schedules, what type of food do they eat, how they handle traveling from country to country, and handling that travel time along with their practice time. And it's really neat to kind of get in the mindset, even both good and bad. There are days that Super JJ had a bad day, and he would explain why he's having a bad day and how the travel's been affecting him and things like that. So it's really enlightening to see that. And I'm really excited to see how all of that training prepared them for Seat Story, because I'd love to see them do really well
in Seat Story. Yeah, he's living up to his name. He really is life coaching us.
Yes, really true. Is. And I just want to say Seat Story is one of my favorite tournaments all year. I look forward to the Seat Story Cups. They're always a lot of fun. You never know what you're going to see. And I highly recommend tuning in this weekend, the 15th. Actually, starts tomorrow. So,
yeah,
starting tomorrow through the 18th.
The tournaments I really look forward to are the DreamHacks, the Seat Story, and Need for Seat outside of the Blizzard Championship Series.
And yeah, the great thing about Seat Story is it's not a very high prize pool tournament. The total prize pool is only $20,000, but there's so much camaraderie, and they have all kinds of little side things where they do side bets and they do some Hearthstone playing at the bar while they're drinking. Of course, not the main tournament, but side stuff that they do, and they really get into the community, because it's actually an event that people can go and go to that part of Germany and actually stay there with the professionals while they're playing in the tournament. So it's kind of neat that they get that whole professional Hearthstone community. And if you have the money and the time, you can go and be part of it.
That's right. That's right. Lots of things to do at those events. And we're going to be having a similar event minus all the pros and whatnot this coming Saturday. So should be a lot of fun. All right, let's move on. So, Hearthstone Tournament Mode. We've talked about it. We've dreamed about it. We've pretty much written it off.
About it.
Yeah, we've pretty much written it off as ever getting to see it as an in-game mode from the devs. Well, China apparently decided no wasn't good enough. So there's an add-on app in China known as Hearthstone Box that was written and created by the company that actually distributes Hearthstone in China. Because it's not Blizzard.
That's NetEase.
NetEase, that's right.
Yep.
And so they have actually brought tournament mode to Hearthstone. Why don't you tell us a little more about it, Zeroshio?
Basically, it's an app that all of the tournament attendees are required to load on their computer that basically pulls data straight from the Hearthstone client to keep track of what they've played, their decks, and it'll even you even choose which decks you're playing in the tournament, and it will not let you select any other deck. And in the case of a ban, when your opponent bans a deck, it won't let you select that deck either. So it actually controls what you're allowed to do in the Hearthstone client while you're in tournament mode. So it's a straight on tournament mode. Now, it isn't adding to the client where you can get online and do tournaments. It's a separate app that allows tournament goers to basically enter into it, and it keeps from cheating, and it also keeps track of your decks and records what was in your deck while you were playing. So it's kind of like both a tracking system and a security system to make sure that people aren't cheating or using any other applications.
Yeah.
I'd love to see something like this implemented. I know a lot of people want to have the client, that type of client in the Hearthstone, that kind of functionality in Hearthstone, but I'm fine with it being an app that would be required if you're doing any online tournaments. I think that would allow for online tournaments to have a little integrity, so there's less cheating and foul play, but at the same time, it doesn't devalue things like Fireside Gatherings.
Yeah. Vrasika, thoughts on in-game tournament modes?
Oh, you guys already know my thoughts on it. I'm sure actually Max would have loved to have had that bit where you can't queue in with the wrong deck.
Too soon.
I do think tournament mode would affect Fireside Gatherings. I think it would do a great deal to harm them. So China can keep it as far as I'm concerned.
Well, the thing is with this is it's an add-on used by online tournament providers anyway. So it's not going to change it. There's already online tournaments. It just gives them a tool to run those tournaments that are already running.
That's just it. It as long as it stays there, but I think the three of us both know it's not just going to stay there.
I don't know. Blizzard seems to be pretty adamant about not introducing it directly into the client. Now,
it's because they're smart.
Well, they're very invested in their Fireside Gatherings program and yes. Growing it. They really want that one-on-one interaction of being able to sit across the table from your opponent and play the game and be able to sit and talk to players and have a good time together. And that's Blizzard's angle on it. And I'm sure, you know, there's, like Zeroshio said, there's all kinds of third-party people out there running cups and tournaments online. So, I mean, if you want to do that, the options are already there.
I'm not a fan of downloading third-party software onto my machine that controls another, for the sole purpose of controlling another program.
Yeah.
I could understand that. And I just think it would be real useful for something like Vicious Syndicate does their Tuesday night hypes. I think it would be good for them. Some of these other smaller online tournament organizations have a hard time enforcing some of the rules. It would be good for them. It would be good for something like a DreamHack where they don't have to have all the checks and balances, people running around, submitting decks. It's done through the client on your computer while you're there, and it's less downtime and you know, kind of logistics. I think it would make things run smoother.
I can see that. And don't get me wrong, I don't want you guys to think that I'm saying that the idea doesn't have any merit. I would just, if I'm going to get something like this that affects Hearthstone, I'd rather it come from Blizzard.
Yeah.
Like, I have a hard enough time trusting deck trackers when I put them on. And whenever they freak out, I freak out.
So, and that's fair.
And it brought up third party doesn't sit well with me. So if it's going to be instituted, I would rather Blizzard do it. But I think there's a fine line between doing that and then opening it up for everything else. So.
And there is some concern for these Chinese tournaments. What if there is somebody who has a legitimate disconnect issue and the app on the computer doesn't upload the information properly? Does that game count as a loss? Does that match count as a loss? Do they then have to forfeit their position in a tournament? So there are concerns, and I think this would be a good place for them to flesh out those concerns and see if after it's been used maybe for a full year, for a full season in China, if there's any parts of it that bring any merit to pull towards the client or pull over to other regions.
Okay. All right. Well, we are currently in week 2 now of the full release of the Mean Streets of Gadget Zan. And I think we can pretty much all agree that the meta is in a very yarr state.
All right. Big pirates an inch, they'll take a yard.
That's right.
Mean Streets of Gadget Zan.
All right, we're going to start with Versica on this one. Where do you feel the meta is at in this point? Do you feel like it's in a good state, or do you feel like there's room still to grow?
I still think it's in a balanced state, and I think that's good for the game. We kind of talked about it a little bit last week, but the fact that this is the second straight week where you can go in with a control deck, or you can go in with a mid-range deck, or you can go in with an aggro deck, and have a pretty good chance of winning, regardless of where you are on the ladder. I think that's important for that overall health of Hearthstone. There's still a lot of pirate out there, but there's still ways to beat that pirate, and there's still... There's no necessarily known counter meta, which is what I like to play on the ladder. So it's really hard to build a deck and expect to get consistent 75-80% win rate, which is what I'm used to when I play. I don't play very many games per month. I get my rank through quality, not quantity. So in this meta, I can't really play one deck for 5 straight games and expect to get, 3 or 4 of an aggro deck or 3 or 4 of a control deck. So for me, it's been very up and down, and I've enjoyed it. It's made it more fun. My rank doesn't show that it's made it more fun, but it definitely has made ladder more enjoyable for me this month.
Awesome. All right, Zerotio, thoughts?
I really like where we're at. I know there's a lot of pirate, and not just pirate warrior, but pirate rogue, and also pirate shaman. I have even seen a pirate paladin. There's a lot of pirate, mainly because it's taken the aggro role. Instead of having different aggro decks and different classes, they're all pirate-style aggro decks with a little bit of flair thrown in. The shaman kind of steers towards early aggro, and then it has some mid-range elements in it. And I kind of like that some of the archetypes are melding together. And then priest is running a dragon deck, but it's not your normal dragon priest. It's really more of a mid-range dragon priest, and I'm really liking the style. I'm having a hard time beating him with my shaman deck, and as soon as I get all the cards needed for the mid-range dragon priest, I'm going to start playing it more because it's fun to play against. I could just imagine playing with it. I'm having so much fun because I'm seeing things other people aren't doing. Every once in a while, people will throw in a tech card or throw in something that I'm just like, wow, I can't believe they did that. And on the flip side, I'm doing things that people aren't expecting. They're not expecting bloodlust in my shaman. And yes, I'm playing shaman. I'm enjoying shaman a lot. They don't expect devolve in my shaman. And I get a lot of wows, whether they're sarcastic or not,
yeah,
whenever I play those cards. And it's a lot of fun to have that reaction and have them to go, wow, I didn't play around bloodlust and they just beat me. Or I didn't play around devolve and now my wonderful 7/7 Flame Wreath Faceless is a 3-mana minion. What you gonna do?
Right. So yeah, that's I'm kind of in agreement. I haven't been playing a whole lot because of issues with just stuff going on, getting ready for tournaments this weekend and getting ready for Christmas. But what I have gotten to play has been a lot of fun. I've been playing a lot of Reno decks. I'm surprising to myself, because of all the Grimy Goons talk I did prior to release, I'm finding myself playing a lot of Priest, a lot of Warlock right now.
Oh wow, Reno Warlock is ridiculous. It's so much fun to try to beat them before they hit that big curve.
Right. Yeah.
Real quick before we go too much further, if you are watching the show and you're confused as to where we are on the chat, even though we are streaming on Avanti's, we're hosting it on the ECMMO Gamers page. So that is where the chat is actually located for the show. So just to clear up any confusion there.
Yeah. Chatting live on the twitch.tv/ECMMOGamers page. Watching, if you want to watch the show live, you can watch it on either page because we are hosting it. But yeah, we had some technical difficulties at the beginning of the show with our normal page. We'll figure that out post haste, and hopefully everything will be back to normal next week. But we wanted to get you guys a show because we have a lot. We had some cool stuff, and we've got a really cool deck to talk about here in just a few minutes. Tavern Brawl this week is a new Tavern Brawl. It is the Battle for Gadget Zan. Mix it up with the bosses for Gadget Zan. You have a few friends, in quotes, in high places that'll show you the ropes. So I've only had time to play one Tavern Brawl today. I got to play as Paladin. My opponent was playing Priest, and I had a really great buff curve, and my minions just outpaced my opponent's minions. And my opponent ended up conceding on turn 8 when I dropped a 7/7 Tyrion, because he had gotten buffed as well. So, my opponent just up and conceded at that point, and I had a lot of fun with it. I'm planning on going back and checking it out again because I understand you play as the, from the different factions. So
Yes.
the only ones I've seen are Priest and Paladin. Zerotio, I've heard Jade Lotus is out there. Is it a druid?
Yes. Basically, what happens is you're one of the three factions. If you are Grimy Goons, you get Paladin. If you're a Cabal, you get Priest. If you are Jade Lotus, you get Druid. So if you have a class quest for Paladin, Priest, or Druid, you can do them in this Tavern Brawl. Now, I queued up three times, and each time I got a different one. So I don't know if they've done that on purpose, where you'll never play the same one twice in a row or something like that. But I did three, and I got Druid first, then Paladin, then Priest, and then I got Druid again on my fourth time. I went 2-2. Everybody's been saying that Jade Lotus is really bad, but both of my wins came off of Druid. Came off Jade Lotus, and it might be because I'm a seasoned Druid player and I've played a lot of Jade Druid, so I kind of know how to work that curve. But I enjoyed it a lot. Now, I will give you a tip. If you're playing Cabal, save any of your spot removal for after Don Honcho hits the board, because he's probably going to have something big come down.
Yeah. My when I played Don Honcho, he hit a Argent Horse Rider. That was nice.
Yeah, it hit Argent Horse Rider on mine too.
Versika, you had a chance to play yet?
I did. I'm 1-5, but that was because every time I queued into Grimy Goons, I conceded. So I played three games as Grimy Goons, two games as Cabal. I lost my first game as Cabal and won my second.
Cool. Yeah, I'm gonna probably go back and give it another shot. probably sometime this weekend while I'm sitting around during tournaments. But
now the decks are set decks.
Yes.
So obviously like Druid is J Druid. Your Paladin is a grimy goon style Paladin with a heavy curve.
Yeah.
You do have Tyrion in there.
Yeah.
And then your priest is actually a dragon priest.
Yeah.
And there are two dragon fire potions, and use them wisely.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
It's fun though when you queue or when you Nether Spot Historian into Cro-Magnus and they can't remove Cro-Magnus and you draw two straight dragon fire potions, so you have four dragon dragon fire potions.
Wow. It was cool.
Needless to say, that was the game I won.
Yeah.
As a priest, I cast the Cabal one that lets you discover a class card of one of either class, and I got a polymorph potion. Couldn't cast it that turn because I cast other things. And then he threw down Don Honcho and one minion with one card in his hand, and it buffed it. And so I was like, obviously it's something he really wants. Buff. So I threw down my secret. Next turn, he throws out Tyrion with the buff, and it gets sheeped.
Oh, wow.
Nice. Very so, nice. So, real quick, since we're done with Tavern Brawl anyway, I had one of those games that's just never going to happen again.
Okay.
So I wanted to talk about it.
So there I was?
So there I was. So, I think it was Sunday. You were in the chat, Zerotio, when I was talking about the Reno Mage. So, yes. In my Reno Mage, I play a one of called Delra Drake.
It'll
fill my curve. And it's very advantageous to be able to use that hero power twice. Well, I forget the try. Is it the courier that gives you the
courier, yes, Cabal Courier.
So I Cabal couriered into the Unchained.
Wow,
Raza.
Did you figure out what I'm doing with this? Where I'm going with this yet, Avantes?
Oh yeah.
Death. So Kaldara Drake lets you use your hero power multiple times a turn.
Yeah.
And the Unchained lets you do it for zero mana. So my opponent was a good enough sport to allow me to try to do all 30 points of damage in one turn, which I did manage to do, just barely.
Just before the rope.
Barely beat the rope. You know, he's hoping the whole time, beat the rope, beat the rope, beat the rope, beat the rope. Come on, don't beat the rope.
I was clicking and moving as fast as I could.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like cheering on a lame racehorse.
Yep. Exactly. It's like that's awesome. Cheering on that hump day camel.
All right, let's go ahead and talk about this week's deck because I'm excited. This is a fun deck. This is a deck Rasika built 2 hours roughly after the release of Mean Streets. I went over to talk to him about something else completely unrelated, and he was like, "I'm sure whatever you have to say is important, but you have to come see this first." And I was just like, "Okay." I was just gonna tell you your house is on fire, but let's go see what's happening in Hearthstone, you know?
Yep.
So this is what he has so titled Shiver Me Timbers. It is a rogue deck that is kind of a cross between a classic Miracle Rogue and a current Pirate Rogue. It's really funky and really fun. So I'm going to run down the deck list, and then I'll turn it over to Rasika to talk about how the deck plays. So you've got 2 Backstab, 2 Counterfeit Coin, 2 Preparation, 2 Shadow Step, 1 Mistress of Mixtures, 1 Patches the Pirate, 1 Acidic Swamp Ooze, 1 Bloodmage Thalnos, 2 Doomsayers, 2 Eviscerates, 2 Gang Ups, 2 Loot Hoarders, 1 Shiv, 2 Fan of Knives, 2 South Sea Captain, 2 Tomb Pillager, 1 Leroy Jenkins, and 2 Gadget Zan Auctioneer. So, Vrsika, gang up.
Oh, yeah. So, one of my first decks that one of the first packs that I opened that wasn't on stream. It was my free packs. I got patches.
Nice.
So the first thing that I thought of when I saw patches was, yeah, he's great, but it's a 1/1 charge and you get him for free, but you have to have a pirate in your hand, so you have to put pirates in the deck, and so you have to make sure that you put one out on the first turn. I'm like, that just doesn't... Now, mind you, this is 2 hours after the expansion came out, so I was like, I just don't think that that seems very good. And then I was just like, but now if you had a South Sea Captain in your hand, then it becomes a 2/2 charge. That's a little bit better. But it would be better if I could put two patches in my hand. Well, or two patches in the deck. I was like, but wait, I can gang up patches. I wonder if that works. So I built like a preview of this deck with the sole purpose of just getting out South Sea Captain and patches, and then shadow stepping patches back to my hand after ganging him up to see if I could do the 10 points of damage. And so I was able to pull it off. I'm like, wonder if I could do that twice. So then my whole purpose at that point was to just try and get as many patches put back in my deck as possible. And then I was like, well, what if I could hold it off to... What if I could play patches, gang him up, and then instead of pulling the patches back, pull the South Sea Captain back to my hand and wait for the second South Sea Captain? It's like, that could work. So I played around with it, and I was having so much... Like, I was over here in my space, which is right next door. There's a wall that separates my space and Avanti Sun's space, and I was just cackling. I was laughing so hard every game. And I was sure that Cole thought I was nuts.
Yeah.
Just sitting over here laughing to myself. But I had a lot of fun to play it. And since the time that I built this, several other people have stumbled upon this. Several pros have stumbled upon this. And I'm sure that their lists are more refined. And I'm sure that there's several things that we could do to make the list a little more aggressive. But this is the original list that I built. So I thought it would be fun to bring it out and hopefully have a good time playing it. But if, we get into that first game, and we want to work with Twitch chat, I don't mind to pop out and make a couple of changes as we go along, just to see how they work.
Okay. All right. Well, cool. So, yeah, besides the whole gang up patches combo, you've still got your kind of traditional Miracle Rogue, Gadget Zan Auctioneer, into coin, into counterfeit coin, into prep, into backstab, into shadow step, into just draw your cards to get that draw engine going. And if you can't kill them with patches, you can always just kill them with Leroy.
Right, and I've actually several times pulled off the Leroy, shadow step, Leroy combo to finish them off. You'll notice that it doesn't run cold bloods, and that's because I've got the counterfeit coins in. I wanted that card draw from the Gadget Zan, but occasionally it comes in really handy throughout the game as well. So it's mostly just board control, aggressive use of Doomsayer, keeping it keeping the board clear and manageable, and then using patches to soften them up and finish them off with Leroy.
Yeah. All right. Well, cool. Well,
I played this deck a little bit, and I noticed that since there wasn't any cold bloods, my Leroy fell real short. So I took out Leroy and put in Edwin Van Cleef.
Mm-hmm.
And on quite a few occasions, I had to coin, and my opponent put out their turn one minion that seems to be real popular right now. And I was able to backstab, coin, counterfeit coin into an 8/8 Edwin.
Yep.
And they exhaust all of their resources on that Edwin that then I pull out the South Sea Deckhand combo, South Sea Captain combo, and, you know, South Sea Captain into Patches. gang up on Patches into Shadow Step on Patches, put him back out to get three more 2/2s on the board, doing a total of 10 points of damage in that one turn.
Yeah.
Because I was able to exhaust a lot of their resources on Edwin, they had nothing left.
I think at this point, if I were to put Edwin in, I would probably take out Mistress of Mixtures.
Do you find Mistress of Mixtures? I mean, we've talked about in the past how she's kind of this set's version of Zombie Chow. She's a one mana 2/2, I believe. And when she dies, both players are healed for 4. Do you find she plays an integral part, or do you think you could just drop her for Edwin at any point?
You can just drop her for Edwin at any point. I've got her in because the deck doesn't really have any heal, and sometimes I found myself just being one turn away from being able to deliver the killing blow. So I put her in just as a way to get that 4 extra points or to get that extra turn. But, you know, that's because I was trying to play a very control. So if you wanted to go a little more aggressive with the Edwin Van Cleef, and if you wanted to play him early, like Zerosho suggested, Mistress of Mixtures would be the card I would take out.
Okay.
That probably worked out better. I know Mistress of Mixtures is real popular right now because in a mid-range to control style deck, you're really not worried about doing face damage to your opponent. You really want to clear his board. And if you face against the aggro who's just going to go face constantly, putting the Mistress down, either they're going to clear it early and save you some face damage, or they're going to have to kill it after you've taken some damage, and it's going to negate the damage that they have done to you. And healing your opponent at that point isn't a problem because they're probably at full health anyways.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, cool. Well, I am looking forward to seeing this deck get played, as I am every week. I love the play portion of our show. If you guys just listened to our audio podcast, you should really think about heading over to YouTube and checking out our VODs and seeing the play portions of the show. So we have a lot of fun there. And with that said, any last thoughts, gentlemen? Zerosho, start with you.
First off, thank you for everybody in chat. Obviously, we started a little late. Had some technical difficulties, and I really appreciate you guys being patient and being dedicated. Everybody's still here and check and hanging out like you do every week. I really do appreciate it. Special shout out to my man, Slow Madman. That's one of my coworkers at work, and I really appreciate him supporting our show and checking us out. That's all I got. We have an awesome fireside gathering this weekend, but I'm sure Avantes is going to talk more about that.
Rasika, what do you got?
Well, if you'll notice, I do have my holiday sweater on, but it is Star Wars because it is Star Wars week. So Christmas early a little bit for us. I will have a new shirt on next week that is absolutely awesome that my wonderful wife got for me, and you guys will love it. But I thought I would just do my Christmas shirt this week. You guys going to go see Star Wars this weekend?
Probably not going to have time.
Yeah, I'm not going to have time. Plus, my wife and I tend to like to go to those things while I hate waiting too long. Usually a couple days after the release because it's not as crowded and not as crazy. So we will probably go see it probably during the week next week.
Yeah, I'm kind of leaning towards Tuesday of next week.
Tuesday is discount ticket prices over at our theater here, so that's probably when I will do it as well.
Ours as well, so.
Fair enough, as long as you guys go see it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We'll see it.
let me tell you, if you guys, off topic, if you guys have not heard, Star Wars Rogue One has all the critics buzzing about how it's the best Star Wars movie that has been made since the originals. They're saying this is the prequel we deserve. Not necessarily the one we needed, but the one we deserved.
Well, technically not a prequel, it's a sequel.
So
Star Wars semantics. Disney.
Yeah, yeah.
That's all I gotta say, Disney.
So yeah, go check it out. All right, I want to throw a huge shout out to Riddle Me Batman and Diamond Fairy for their follows. Thank you. We love having new followers to the channel.
And Riddle Me Bat is one of our local heroes for our fireside gatherings.
A local tavern hero. So I also want to talk about that just a little bit. So we are hosting two firesides this weekend, one on Saturday night in Knoxville, Tennessee at Green's Tavern, and another one on Sunday at Level Up Games. Those are both casual. Come have some fun, hang out with us, play some Hearthstone. And then next month we are hosting two Tavern Hero qualifiers in Knoxville on January the 7th and January the 21st in Knoxville at Level Up Games and Hobbies. So if you are interested in breaking into esports at the entry level, come out, have some fun, play some competitive Hearthstone. If you are not interested in getting into competitive and you still want to come out and play and have fun, we are going to run a casual fireside event simultaneously on the 21st. So I will probably be running the Tavern Hero qualifier. Versica will probably be running the fireside. Come out.
And I'll be making the lunch runs.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
So just,
the most important role.
Yeah, Zorochio has the most important role.
Food.
So come out, hang out with us, play some Hearthstone, have some fun. And that's going to do it for us this week. If you are joining us on
Twitch. One more thing, real quick, as I always do. A reminder, the Fireside Gathering this Saturday is at Green's Tavern. It is 21 and up because it is actually at a bar. Also, if you want information on any of the local Fireside Gatherings for both of our Tavern Heroes and our just a casual Fireside Gatherings, if you join the Knoxville Hearthstone Facebook group, we'll give you all that information on everything that happens locally.
Or if you're looking for a Fireside Gathering in your area, check out firesidegatherings.com. All right, let's try this again. If you are joining us on Twitch or YouTube, please stay tuned for the live play portion of our show. If you are listening via the audio podcast, we'd like to thank you for joining us. Remember, you can follow us on Twitter at HeroPower_cast. And you can find all of our past episodes on YouTube at youtube.com/ECMMOGamers or on our website at HeroPowerHS.com. If you enjoy the show, you can help to support and improve it like all of our awesome patrons at Patreon.com/HeroPower. And as always, we'll see you again next week.
And don't forget to use your hero power.
Alrighty, folks.
So, would it be a hero power outro if I didn't interrupt you?
Yeah, probably.
Really?
Alright, so, Versica, while we get everything set up, tell us a little more about Vi-Force.
Alright, so, at the start of the show, remember I said that it's a little too late to get your rig before Christmas, your new gaming rig before Christmas. It is not, however, too late to start planning for your new gaming rig for the start of the new year. Well, one of the great things about Vi-Force is that they do offer multiple ways to get your machine. You can either finance through them, you can put it on your own card, or you can pay outright. That kind of flexibility allows you to either spread those payments over time or use your Christmas money that you're going to be getting to buy your new gaming rig. They have rigs for all price levels, and if you're really looking into to spending 2017 getting into some esports or some competitive gaming, you need to start with good equipment. And it's important that you buy your good equipment through people that give you good customer service and good advice. You find all of those things at Vi-ForceGaming.com. So go to Vi-ForceGaming.com, click on the products page, see what they have to offer. Or you can go to HeroPowerHS.com, click on the link at the side. That'll take you right to Vi-Force's page. If you have any questions, click the Contact Us page. It'll get you in touch with the guys at Vi-Force, and they will be happy to answer anything that you have going on. And, yeah, it's an exciting time. for me, waiting on my ByForce machine, and I hope that you guys get to experience the same thing.
Awesome. All right, so let's check out this Rogue deck. I'm really stoked to see it get some play.
You know, it's funny. So I logged in, and I've not been on this page of my decks really since we talked about it. I've been playing mostly on the Shaman and the Priest side. So I flicked over to the deck and realized that after I made Shiver Me Timbers, I made a deck also called Shiver Their Timbers. And I just pulled up the deck list, and it includes Edwin Van Cleef.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
That's awesome. All right, are you ready?
Yeah,
are
that
you
Edwin, searching Edwin for a... combo is crazy.
Yeah, I'm ready. He starts spectating me.
All right,
so looking at this hand and seeing that it's Paladin, so it's almost definitely going to be Grimy Goons.
Mm-hmm.
I think
could be the Murloc variation.
Yeah, I think keeping the Fan of Knives is questionable. Definitely sending back the Gadget Zan. Murloc, or the Backstab and Doomsayer, I'm keeping both of them. It's important for that early game tempo.
The Fan of Knives Backstab may be good to knock off Divine Shield to then backstab a buffed up, you know, Argent Squire or something.
That's what I'm thinking. So I'm thinking I'm just going to throw back the Gadget Zan Auctioneer.
Okay. Because Divine Shields are pretty prevalent in this deck. If it's the standard kind of mid-rangey style Grimy Goons. And they are annoying when they're on minions that are buffed up. Ooh, he's got a bad hand.
Yeah, it looks like it. So, our hand is Fan of Knives, Gang Up, Backstab, Doomsayer, Coin, and Shadow Step. So, what are you thinking? Just pass?
I'm thinking pass. I don't see any point using the coin.
I think with the point of damage. With the abusive sergeant toss out, I think a Doomsayer on turn 2 or 3 might actually be good here.
Yep. I'm thinking the same thing. But I'm thinking third turn.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I agree with you.
Go ahead and just take out this guy since he's a goblin.
Yep. And then if he does throw down something that does threaten Doomsayer, we could use our weapon or backstab or a combination of both.
Yep.
Yep.
We could even eviscerate if we had to. Oh, wow.
Into a 4-3 bluegill.
I'm okay with using backstab and ban here. He's only got 2 cards in hand.
I like that play. I think that backstab fan was a good hold, and it works perfect for this. And then whatever he throws out, we could eviscerate with the combination of a Doomsayer.
Yeah, so we drew into Loot Hoarder. The Fan of Knives gave us another Fan of Knives.
Okay.
That's all right. Probably Doomsayer on turn 4.
Yeah.
Yeah. We got the gang up in our hand, so that's a good start. Ooh.
Into a 3-5. So 3,
that's
4, 5.
That's 6 power on the
board. That is 6 power. He only needs 1 to be able to. But I don't think he has it. You want to roll the dice and
With 1 card in his hand, I don't think he does. Plus, if he does, that's almost like 7 points of healing.
Yeah, that's
if you
that's
think
true.
About it, at 7 points, it's not going to your face.
And you need what? 1 more turn to pull off the gang up combo?
I could do it right now.
Well, that's true.
You could with the coin. But I wouldn't do it with what's on the board. Okay. I think since he has 1 card in his hand, unless it's Divine Favor, we're ahead.
What about this? I mean, you can take away a point by Doomsayer weapon, kill the taunt. Then he only has 5 on the board.
That's true.
Yeah, but if that's a consecrate, then it still doesn't. What about Doomsayer coin fan?
That works too.
Yeah.
and it lowers our hand size for if it is divine favor.
Now I've got Leroy.
Oh yeah, nice. Leroy and Shadow Step if we wanted to.
Yeah. So he's going to just life tap this turn probably and attack face.
Yeah. This sets us up for a good South Sea deckhand turn. Because see, you can do 10 points of damage by South Sea.
Oh, and prep.
Go to face, gang up, and then throw him back out and go to face with everything again. That's 10 points total.
But again, if that card is
consecrate. No, it can be consecrate because it got buffed up.
Did it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. It's sparkling. Now he could have drawn into consecrate.
So what about South Sea Deckhand, Shadow Step, Prep, Gang Up? No. What about South Sea Deckhand, Patches, Prep, Gang Up, Shadow Step to South Sea, and Playing Back?
Yeah, that works.
Okay.
Yeah, attack for two.
Well, if you wouldn't have to prep. Yeah, okay. No, you're good. Well, I guess it doesn't matter which way you do it. You could shadow step the patches, and it would have been one less mana you could have daggered up. It would have had the same result.
Yeah, that's true.
It's pretty much the same line though.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's what I was actually thinking. That's why I attacked with the patches.
Then you would have had an extra mana.
And an extra 2 points.
We could have even eviscerated face if we want. Now he's digging. He could get into consecrate, but he would have consecrated.
Oh, first. There's a 5/5 war leader.
This is the Murloc variation.
An abusive sergeant, and that's gonna do it, I think, isn't it?
11, yeah, with Leroy.
Yep.
Yep, that'll do her. Turn 6. Woo!
Gotta like it.
Man. It's good. So, you had golden patches a second. Is that because you had a golden gang up? Or?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, that was something Versika and I had actually talked about yesterday. I was driving home, and I was like, we may have to do some science. I'm curious. If you have a golden gang up, do you get golden patches? There you go. There's the answer.
That's pretty cool. I didn't realize that. That's neat.
And it was funny because I got both of those gang ups, both of those golden gang ups, out of the packs that I won for picking Pavel. But I totally forgot that I had them. So I was still using regular gang ups. And actually, I went in to make them, and I'm like, oh, I already have them.
All right, so we're playing a Warlock this time, and our opening hand is Preparation, Doomsayer, and Mistress of Mixtures.
This is likely a Reno.
Yeah.
Doomsayer may be good to try to hold to, like, turn 4 when he's going to put down a Twilight Drake.
Yeah.
But that would be the only time. I've only seen one zoo in, like, 50 games.
Yeah. So I think Mistress is going to go back. I think Prep needs to go back too.
Okay.
You'll need Mistress late game to heal back some of the early damage. To keep yourself out of Leroy combo. Ooh, that's not good. We could have all the Doomsayers we want. Well, we got our Celsi. And the gang up, so.
We really needed to keep that Prep, then. We got the Doomsayer.
Well, this allows us to Doomsayer turn 4 to set up for a South Sea turn 5. Hopefully we draw into the Shadow Step.
Alright, there's a Peddler. That's pretty expected.
Mm-hmm.
It's also problematic, too, because he could have power overwhelming.
Well, usually, if they take longer than a second or two to pick, they don't have power overwhelming. Yeah. Power overwhelming is almost always a snap pick.
And Nibbleswap brought up a good point in chat. We need to watch out for possible dirty rat.
Yeah. Of course, if we dirty rat, does summon activate patches?
Summon activates patches, yes.
Do you have to play?
Yeah, I don't know.
I think any time a pirate hits the board.
Ooh, this is a tough choice. Do we go ahead and go on our normal plan and Doomsayer? Or do we Tomb Pillager? Okay.
And I'll go ahead and take the damage from...
Chat says no. Gotcha.
No, it's about... Oh, yeah, it's a battle cry. But...
Yeah. So no, it would not trigger.
What's a battle cry?
Patches
isn't...
So you actually have to play it from your hand in order to trigger patches.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, patches isn't a battle cry. I just don't know if it's if it says play or summon. I can't remember.
Okay. So what's your play this turn?
South Sea deckhand or South Sea captain into Ganga.
I don't know if this is Reno. Oh, I think we could do that, but I don't think this is Reno because he put out. Well, no, he got the Leprechaun off of Peddler. Never mind, it could still be Reno. Okay.
Okay. Gang up. Yep.
Yep. We actually have a second gang up for when we get patches out again.
Yep. If he doesn't clear patches this time, it's going to be ugly for him next turn.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. If we draw, it, oh my gosh! If we draw into, well, we can't do both because we fill up our port.
He is not.
Yeah, he is.
Mortal Coil. Mortal Coil.
Yeah, he is. But that's okay. Whenever we get our next pirate, it'll summon them all back out.
Yeah.
And then we can gang up at that time.
As long as, well, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Probably going to want to save our Eviscerates for Burst.
So, what do you think about Gadget Zan or even the Tomb Pillager, maybe?
I think I'm going to Tomb Pillager here.
Yeah, I think we're going to...
Tomb Pillager attack face with your weapon and re-weapon?
Yeah.
I think you want to do something with Gadget Zan, and just doing a coin without a follow-up would be rough.
Yeah.
Hopefully he plays something we can kill with Eviscerate, then we can Gadget Zan... Coin, Eviscerate. I probably don't want to do that now. Well, we probably could. Depends if he clears the 5-4.
Yeah, I mean, we could attack into it, Gadget Zan, Coin, Eviscerate.
We could.
Draw two cards. Keep both of our minions.
Ooh, there's the other South Sea. We could just run into it, South Sea, Eviscerate, and then gang up again.
See, I'm thinking if we hit him, then we put him on a clock.
Yeah, I like South Sea into gang up, into Eviscerate even.
Wait, hold on a second. If we South Sea into... Yeah, how much damage are we doing? That's 2,
that's
4, 15, 6...
15 points of damage with what's on the board. And the with Eviscerate? Yeah.
Ooh.
What if we go ahead...
And just go face
go
and let him
and
blow
auctioneer?
Up? And Eviscerate face? Auctioneer and Eviscerate face?
I'd be afraid we draw into patches.
That's fine. We can throw him out for one mana. He'll still get buffed.
Well,
I think we go face, auctioneer, coin, eviscerate face. And go face. Do we get it off? Because the patches isn't a big deal. It's still going to be a 2-2 charge. We could even throw out patches, gang up patches, and then throw out South Sea Deckhand.
Yes.
And get more patches.
Yes. And that could be enough for lethal.
That will be enough for lethal.
With dagger up, it should be.
He has to reno this turn or he's dead.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, we got him.
Yep.
Wow. If he must not have reno.
Oh, and shadow step. So that
and
works.
And shadow step.
So no. You need
No.
You need
patches first.
Patches first.
Yeah, you'll have to patch
him. Unless you're going to shadow step him.
I'm going to shadow step patches.
Okay. So you're gonna South Sea Captain.
You'll get more patches the other way, but that's all right. That's fine.
Doesn't matter. He's still dead. So now gang up.
Gang up.
Attack for four.
And then throw patches out again. We don't even have to shadow step.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, you don't even have to shadow step.
Now he's have dead. Enough to dagger up.
It doesn't
dagger
matter.
Up and go face. Is that 12?
Yeah.
Or is that 10? That's 12. Okay.
Yeah.
My math was off.
That's game.
I thought we were just going to get 5 patches.
Wow. Quite possibly our fastest 2 wins ever.
That's pretty crazy. That's awesome. Okay, so I played this deck and I was playing it wrong.
How were you playing
it? I was doing
it wrong?
The combo too fast. I was trying to do the combo like really early.
Oh, okay.
And I wasn't setting up and I was playing it like an aggro and not a mid range.
Gotcha.
Okay. Mid range burst. It's a combo deck. It is
a combo deck.
This yes. is the akin to 4 Savage Roar.
Yeah. It very exactly very similar. Yeah.
When I saw patches and thought South Sea Captain, I was just like, wait. This is like Force of Nature all over again.
I mean, your total damage for the same number of cards is slightly less, like by 4 points. It's,
but that's
definitely
what
10
Blizzard
points
wanted
burst.
Because obviously yeah. the other was way too powerful.
Yeah, the 14 points was too much. So 10 yeah. points is a good, nice, solid number. But if you get a couple extra pieces of it and a couple turns patient, you can burst it out from like
yeah.
what did we see there, 12.
Yes. Yeah.
It'd be you could get as much as 15 if you had 2 South Sea Captains and 5 patches.
Yes, that's correct.
So but that's like a perfect storm.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so let's do final thoughts on the decks. Versica, tell us a little more about the deck, you know.
Oh, I love this deck. I have a blast playing it. Right now this deck, Reno Mage and Reno Priest are the reasons that I haven't already gotten Golden Shaman. I mean, I'm having so much fun playing them that right now, Shaman actually, for the first time ever, Shaman feels like a little bit of a grind to me. So I'm having so much fun playing these, it's really hard to get on the ladder and push through that Shaman.
Okay.
Words you never thought would come out of my mouth.
Yeah, exactly. Zerosio, give us your last thoughts.
I was playing this deck wrong. I know how to play it right now. Rogue is the only class I don't have to level 60. I'm at, I think, 54 or 55. So I believe this is going to be my deck to get me my level 60 Rogue. And it may make me put a little backseat on my Shaman play for a little bit.
Okay. All right. Awesome.
It's
awesome.
Super fun, and nobody expects it.
Yeah.
Well, it gives me an aggro opportunity now, because my deck's more of a mid-range to control style, and it's really good against aggro. So if I start facing more Dragon Priest, I think this will be perfect to go against Dragon Priest. I do have a couple things. I might throw in a sap or two, maybe in place of the Shiv, because you know, taunt could really wreck you, but that sap
so
might help.
After seeing it played, Zero, and knowing it's more of a mid-range, would you still consider dropping Mistress for Edwin?
Yes. I think even as a kind of a mid-range, you need to buy time to set up that big South Sea Captain burst turn. And if you have an 8-8 Edwin on turn one or two, that's going to make – that's going to 3, sometimes 4-1 your opponent. So they're going to use resources to get rid of it. And if your South Sea combo doesn't kill them, it may stick around long enough to finish them off the next turn. Now, I could see a weakness against the current Shaman meta because there's a lot of Maelstrom Portals and Lightning Storms. I usually do two of them each. Mm-hmm. So that could be the weakness of this deck. But if you're facing a lot of other aggro paladin or aggro rogue or aggro warrior, this is a perfect deck.
Okay, awesome. Well, guys, I believe that is going to do it for us this week.
Thanks for sticking with us through the
technicals. Yes, that is awesome. If you guys have any questions or comments about the show, please email us at heropowerpodcast@gmail.com. Please hit that subscribe button below on YouTube if you've not done so already, and give us a follow on Twitch to be alerted when we go live, even though you didn't get one tonight because of the technical difficulties. With that said, in case this ever happens in the future, you guys want to make sure to be alerted. Follow us at twitch.tv/Versica, twitch.tv/ZeroshioHS, and twitch.tv/AvantesHS. Because if we have technical difficulties in the future, we will more than likely stream to one of those channels and host as we did tonight. So, if you want to make sure you don't miss any of the action, follow us on those channels. If you want more details about how you can support and improve the show, check out patreon.com/heropower. And as always, good gaming.
Have fun, guys.
Thanks, guys.